I'm glad for salvation today, and I'm glad for being in the midst of the presence of the Lord. And I would love for God to come in our midst and do what's to be done. I know the Lord is to have the preeminency of the service. That's my desire. Are you all here? I said, that's my desire, that the Lord have the preeminency. He's the executive agent of the church. And that doesn't bother me. I'm hopeful that we can learn the importance of what it means. You might sit down for a moment. The light, would you I want you to say this with me. Everybody want to say it with me. The life in righteousness. Would you have me say the life in righteousness, or the life of righteousness? It begins when we've been risen with Christ. Would you have me say it begins when we have been risen with Christ? There's no righteousness prior to us being risen with Christ. Would you help me say the light? I think it might be them turn me off. I don't know who's doing what up there, but I heard something. Would you help me say the light in righteousness begins when we were risen with Christ? Through faith of an operation of God. Ever said, through faith of an operation of God. It's Colossians 2 and 12. The life in Christ, the life in righteousness. The life in righteousness begins when we were risen with Christ through the faith of an operation of God. We experience resurrection power. I said, we experience, help me say, resurrection power in our life after we died with him to sin. I'm going to say it again. I say the life in righteousness began when we were risen, raised with Christ through faith of an operation of God. We experience resurrection power in our life after we died with him to sin. And just as God raised Jesus from the dead, praise God, by the power of the Holy Ghost, he also raises us up from the deadness of our sin. So it's normal for God to have the preeminency in a believer's life. It's normal for the Lord to have the right of way. Because there's no righteousness in me, and I don't think there's no righteousness in none of us. But if he wants to have the preeminency, then we give him the preeminency. Are you all here? Would you like me to say that again? Huh? help me say, the life in righteousness began when we were raised with Christ through faith of an operation of God. We experienced his resurrection power in our life after we died with him to sin. And just as God raised up Jesus from the dead by the power of the Holy Ghost, he raised us up from the deadness of our sin. So he wants to have the preeminency of the church. Somebody say yes to Jesus. It's his place to have the control of the church. And this church, I don't know how much we're able to, but we used to know that. And we used to recognize that. And I would like to be able to continue to recognize. And I'm reading again in your Bible. People can only live what they know. Would you help me say, folk can only live what they know and use it, they know what they live. But you can't live no more than what you know. And if you don't know, then you can't live it. Somebody say yes to Jesus. Praise God. And I say it is spiritually disastrous for any church, as far as I'm concerned, to neglect what the scripture teaches concerning the preeminency of the person and the work of the Holy Ghost. We got to recognize his person and recognize his work. Are y'all right? Are y'all with me? He has the preeminency of the church. He's the executive agent of the church. And we have a tendency to give preeminency to people and to programs and to titles and stuff. But I don't mind the Lord taking control of the service. Are y'all here? It would be nice to me if everybody had the Spirit of Christ. And I know our gathering is not just primarily for a program. God wants people to come together so he can minister to us. Is that right? I said, God said, gather my saints together. And God just don't want us to come together just for singing primarily, or just for to look at what we got on. God wants the saints to come together so he can minister to the body. Is that right? All of our needs is right in the body. Are met right in the body. Are y'all here? I'm not a carnal-minded preacher, you all. All of our needs are to be met through the body. Right? Do y'all believe that? Well, I'll give you another. First Corinthians 12 and probably 7. And you keep following me. First Corinthians 12 and 7. We don't see, heaven said, we don't see the Holy Ghost. Come on, heaven said, we don't see Christ. Now hold just a moment. Now just hold just a moment. Now, you all remember Jasper, the ghost. What was his name, Jasper? What was his name? Well, then, you know who I'm talking about. He was white, right? I mean, he just had a white shadow. But he wasn't holy. Would you have me say he wasn't holy? Would you have me say he was a ghost? But he was not holy. And we want to yield to a ghost too. But the ghost we want to yield to is the Holy Ghost. Not, what you say his name was? We ain't trying to yield to Casper, but we do want to yield to a ghost. But a Holy Ghost. You can't see him with your natural eye. But he manifests himself. Would you have me say he manifests himself? And 1 Corinthians 12 and 7 tell you how he does it. I mean, 12 and 7 tell you how he manifests himself.
But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal.
In other words, you don't see Christ, right? But he manifests himself through his ghost. Let me say he manifests himself through his ghost. But he is a Holy Ghost. Not many people, usually not many people see, you know, him. And we see a lot of folks. And usually God is not interested in us seeing one another. He wants us to see his ghost. You have me say, he wants us to see his ghost. That he is holy. And what he does is minister to the saints through his people after they yield themselves to him. Because I'm not interested in seeing you. And I know you're not interested in seeing me. But I don't mind seeing his ghost. Because he doesn't frighten you. Would you have him say he doesn't frighten you? And you won't be afraid when he comes. Remember 1 John 3 and 24. That's not what on my mind. That's not what I got up to say, but that's what I'm saying.
And he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him. And hereby we know that he abideth in us by the Spirit which he has given us.
Come on, help me say, and this is the way we know he. Come on, help me say, and this is the way,
this is the way
we know he abideth
in us
by the Spirit.
Spirit
that he's given us.
He has given us.
It's Jesus who abides in us by his Spirit. He abides in us by his Spirit. We know he's in us, and we know we're in him. And by this we know he abides in us by his Spirit. And let me tell you something, he's not interested in making a name for himself. And he's not interested in being, he's not interested in no glory. He wants all the glory to go to Jesus. Because the Bible says he will not glorify himself. Is that the Bible? Well, you can get it in St. John 16. And he started at the 8th verse. He will not glorify himself, and he's sure not going to glorify me and you. And then in St. John, if you are ready for it, if we're ready for it, are we ready? You're buckling up your seatbelt. Are you ready?
And when he has come,
that he has reference to a ghost. Heaven said that he has reference to a ghost. Heaven said that he has reference to a ghost. just holy. Him say he's just holy. Not Casper. Did I pronounce it right?
And when he is come.
And when he is come.
He will reprove the world of sin.
And if you want to silence him, let sin go unchecked in your life. If you want to silence him, then let sin go unchecked. Because when he comes, he's going to reprove the world of sin.
And of righteousness.
And right. And what?
And of righteousness.
And in other words, he will show me and you what's not pleasing to God. He'll reprove the world, and that means me too. I'm in the world. He reproved the world of sin. He reproved the world of righteousness. And he'll show you the consequences between the two.
And of judgment.
Yes.
Of sin, because they believe not on me.
Anything that's not of Jesus Christ is sin. Would you have me say anything that's not of Jesus Christ? Would you have me say it's sin? Everything that's not of faith is sin. Would y'all like that scripture too? Huh? You like that scripture also? Huh? It's okay with me. It's all right with me. It don't bother me. In Romans, what is it? Romans 4, what is it? 14. Sorry, I think it is. We'll be there. 14 and 22. Romans 14 and 22.
Has thou faith?
Come on, help me say, have thou, do you have it? Do everybody have it? Huh? Would you help me say, all scriptures are given by what? And they are what? Proper for what? Doctrine. For what? Reproof. For what? Instruction. In righteousness, that the man of God will be perfect, and the woman of God be perfect, fully furnished unto every good works. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. And they're proper for doctrine, for reproof. Probably 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy 3, 16. But read where you're at, Sister Rose.
Has thy faith?
Help me say, has thy faith?
Have it to thyself before God.
And I promise you, when you really have faith, you're not making a lot of noise. When you really have faith, I guarantee you, you're not making a lot of noise. You're not trying to prove nothing. You're waiting on God. When you really have faith, you're waiting on the Lord. Usually you're going to be pretty quiet. You ain't bragging. To have it to yourself before God. And happy is he that condemneth not himself in the thing that he, what?
Alloweth.
And he that what?
He that doubteth is damned.
And he that what? Doubteth is what?
Damned if what? He eat.
Right.
Because he eateth not of faith.
And what else?
For whatsoever is not of faith is sin.
That's right. Faith that overcome the world is to believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Or the victory that overcome the world is faith that believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Would you help me say the victory that overcome the world is faith that believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. going back a little bit now. First Corinthians, I guess. 14. What did I say? First Corinthians? Well, that's good. That's real good. But just somebody say yes to Jesus. Praise God for Jesus Christ. In the 27th verse. It's 1 Corinthians 14 and 27. Do you say?
If any man speak in an unknown tongue.
Would you have me say, if any man. This is a sanctified church. Would you have me say, this is the house of Mason. Somebody stand over there and just say, this is the house of Mason. Somebody stand up and help me say, this is the house of Mason.
The house of Mason.
Charles Harrison Mason.
John Harrison
Mason. Somebody stand up over there and tell me, say, this is the house of Mason. Try to stay with it the best we can. Charles Harrison Mason believed in sanctification, and he believed sanctification subsequent to baptism experience. When people feel with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, they should. If they keep praying, they're going to speak in some in either an unknown tongue, other tongue. Or an utterance in tongue. This is an unknown tongue.
That's just
in 1 Corinthians 14. Help me say, this is an unknown tongue. This is unknown tongue. You don't understand. Nobody understands. You're speaking mysteries. And that on the day of Pentecost, they spoke in other tongues. Have me say, on the day of Pentecost, these Galileans spoke in other tongues. They did not speak in unknown tongues. They spoke in other tongue, because those people that come from those 16 different nations understood them, and they didn't need anybody to interpret to them. And they said, how is all these Galileans speaking to us in our native language? Because they were speaking in other tongues, another tongue. And there were 16 different nations there, and they understood them speaking the wonder works of God in their native language that they knew that those Galileans hadn't learned. They were speaking in other tongues, not unknown tongues. And then in the book of Romans, the 8th chapter of the book of Romans, probably 27th verse, talks of an utterance. Have me say an utterance. A groaning. Say, he helpeth thy infirmities. We don't know what to pray for as we ought to. But the one that searches my heart, heaven said, the one that searches my heart, he also know the mind of the Spirit of God. And he'll make intercession for me according to the will of God. With groaning that can't be uttered. So we don't always know what to pray for as we should. But he know my heart, and he know the mind of the Spirit of God. And he'll intercede for me according to the will of God. That's the way he helped us with our infirmities. Somebody say yes to Jesus. Because you and I, our flesh haven't gotten saved. Right? Would you help me say, our flesh haven't gotten saved. And our flesh experiences infirmities because our flesh haven't been redeemed. But while we're waiting for the redemption of our bodies, he helps us with our infirmities. He'll show you how to get healed. He'll show you how to get a door open. That's what groaning is for. You don't know what to pray for. You don't know what to ask for, as we ought to. But he that searches our heart, he know the mind of the spirit. He know the will of God, and he'll make us intercession for us according to God's will. And he does that with groaning that can't be uttered. Is that right? Somebody say yes to Jesus. And where Sister Rose is at, in the 27th verse, that wasn't what I was wanting to get up for, but that's what we're doing. Would you have him say that's what we're doing? It wasn't my intention, but that's where we at.
If any man speak in an unknown tongue.
If he's speaking, now hold it. Help me say, if he's speaking an unknown tongue, he's speaking mysteries, and help me say, and it need to be, help me say, interpreted. Are y'all with me? Help me say, and it need to be interpreted. And if it's not interpreted, then he's just edifying himself. But he's not benefiting the church. So I ask if there's a word from the Lord. So we might get edification. So it could be interpreted. If any man speak, in an unknown tongue, let it be by two. At the most by three. And let that by chorus. And let one person interpret it. But if there be no what?
Interpreter.
Let him keep silence in the church and let him speak to himself and to God. I'm not saying it's not edifying, but we're not getting nothing out of it. And let the prophet do what?
Speak two or three.
Now let me tell you, when they say the prophets, he's not talking about an office. Anybody might prophesy. This is the body. Heaven said, this is the body. And I can't tell who God might speak to. You have the Holy Ghost, and you yielded to the Lord, yielded to God, he might speak through you. Is that right? God doesn't matter who he, God, it doesn't bother the law who he speaks through. God talked to birds. Would you have him say, God talked to birds and donkeys, fish. Would you have him say, God talked to birds. God said to Elijah, I commanded a raven to feed you. You know what the raven did? He fed him his breakfast and his dinner. That's because God talked to birds. Would you have me say, God talked to birds? Even buzzes. Y'all here? Because the earth belongs to the Lord. And fullness thereof. Right? God talked to fish. Jesus got his taxes out of the fish mouth. Are you all here? Talk to roosters. You have him say, God talked to roosters. chickens. Oh, boy. So Peter said, he said, before the rooster crow, you're going to be denying me three times. God talked to donkeys and stuff. Is that right? I know you don't believe it. You don't have to tell me. I know you don't believe it. You're too smart. That's why you don't believe it. You're so smart. Yeah, I know you. You got so much sense. Somebody say yes to Jesus. Praise God for Jesus Christ. You should let the prophet speak two or three and let the other judge. If anything be revealed, are you with me? Now let me tell you something. When you're talking, I'm going to be judging. Let me say, and let the prophet speak two or three, and let me say, and let the others. And while you're talking, don't you think I'm not listening? Because I'm going to be judging. I said, while you talking, I'm going to be listening, and I'm going to be judging. That's true. And I'm more likely going to write it down. If it sounds anything to me, I'm going to write it down, and I'm going to make a note of it. And if it don't happen the way you said it happened, I'm going to say, if it don't happen the way you said it's supposed to happen, you know what I'm going to say about you? You're a lying prophet. Deuteronomy 18, but I don't want to go over there. He said, if it don't come to pass, just know him. He spoke it presumptuously. If anything be revealed to another that sitteth by, he said, let the first hold their peace. And say, he said, for you may all what prophesy one by one, and that all may learn. And they say, and all may be comforted, right? Yeah. Have me say, and the spirits of the prophets.
And the spirits of the prophets.
Or what?
Are subject to the prophets.
And God is not the author of what?
Confusion.
Tell me, somebody help me say, God is not the author of what?
God is not the author.
But God offers peace. Right. Now, would somebody say, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
And the Bible told him, don't grieve the Holy Ghost. And I don't want to grieve the Spirit of God. And I don't want to, Bible said, despise not prophesying. I don't want to despise prophesying, but I know the purpose of prophesying. In 14 and 3, 1 Corinthians. If you all come to Sunday school, then I wouldn't have to be doing what I'm doing now. Did y'all hear
what I just,
hold
on,
just a minute. Oh, just, did you hear what I just said? Huh? I said, did you all hear what I just said? I said, if you all come to Sunday school, I wouldn't have to be doing what I'm doing now. And maybe you come to Bible study. Friday nights or Wednesday nights. Sometime Wednesday night, I'm out on Emerson. Or maybe Tuesday night in the prayer. First Corinthians, because this, it's not the time I want to do this now. But I know one thing. And my dad said, I know two. My dad said, I know two things. dad said, yeah, and I know two things. If you don't sit down, I know something else that you may not know. Somebody say yes to Jesus. In 1 Corinthians 14:3, do you see it? This is the purpose for prophesying.
But he that prophesieth speaketh unto men to edification and exhortation and comfort.
Would you help me say prophesying has three purposes? Edification, exhortation, and what?
Comfort.
And great is he that prophesied and he that speaketh in tongues, except it be interpreted. But when tongues is interpreted, then tongues is equivalent to prophesying. Did I need to say that again? Huh? He said, greater is he that prophesied than he that speaketh in unknown tongue. Because when a person speaking in unknown tongue, they speaking to themselves. And the person that's prophesying is edifying the church. So he said, greater is he that prophesied than he that speaketh in unknown tongue, except it be interpreted. And once unknown tongues is interpreted, then it's equivalent to prophesying. Because it's benefiting somebody more so than the person that's talking. Somebody say yes to Jesus. Now would you just stand and say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now would you just stand and say amen.
Amen.
Now you may be seated. And thank you very kindly. Thank you very kindly. And God bless you. And the saints are really some nice people. Huh? I said, saints are really some nice people. Did you know that? Sanctified people are some nice people. And I love the saints. I love the saints. Did y'all hear what I say? Huh? I love the saints. I want to just say something a little bit. If you all don't mind, I'm hoping that you don't mind. I'm finna say something out of one of my books. Are y'all here? And God bless you. I'm trying to find it. And I solicit all of the saints' prayers. And I'm praying to the Lord that he help me to care. I'm trying to learn how to care. Praying to the Lord that he help me to care. Because the Lord let me know that you're not going to have no enemies in heaven. Will you help me say, you won't have no enemies in heaven, sweetie. You might as well forget it. You're not going to run into your enemy in heaven. So you might as well learn how to care down here. And you learn how to treat everybody right. Let me say, you might as well learn how to treat everybody right down here. Because you will not get to heaven and see somebody you don't like. So you might well try to learn how to like everybody you see down here. Is that right? I mean, if you have a problem with me, then you better try to pray on yourself, because you might end up seeing me in heaven. Is that the truth? If you couldn't get along with me down here, boy, you're going to have a problem. Is that true? You got to spend eternity with me. Look how y'all here. Somebody say yes to Jesus. You're going to have to be with me as long as God lives. And God is not going to go no place. Colossians 2 and 12. The life in righteousness. Help me say the life in righteousness. And God bless you. Brother Leroy tried to find some hand sanitizers, but you can't find none. You can't find no Purell, you can't find nothing. And Leroy done called all them, he done went online, tried to find, nobody got nothing. Everybody done got it, everybody. And watch your hand. Isn't that a song? Watch your hand. Isn't that a song? Do y'all see Colossians 2 and 12? Huh? He's talking about the life in righteousness. Righteousness is more than a term. And I want to talk to you about the life in righteousness. And I want you to understand God's righteousness. Somebody help me say God's righteousness.
Buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who has raised him from the dead.
Yes, that's wonderful, Sister Rose. And there's a scripture that says like pretty much like that in Romans 1 and 4, 3 and 4. This is, heaven said, the life in righteousness. That's not just a judicial term. Would you have me say the life in righteousness is not just a judicial term? It's not just a word. The life in righteousness is, like he said, it's a life. Righteousness is more than just a statement. He made me righteous. That's true. He imputed righteousness to me. But it's more than just a term. It's action. Well, let me say it's action. So it's a lifestyle. It's what you live. What he lives in me. Somebody say yes to Jesus. Praise God for Jesus. Would you read it again, Sister Rose? Colossians 2 and 12. Buried, help me say, buried with him. Would you help me say the Bible called it? Help me say the Bible called it a law. Would you have me say a law of identification? Buried with him. through the faith of an operation of God. And we bury with him after we have died with him. Heaven said we died with him. And our old man was crucified with him.
Yeah, Lord.
Heaven said that's identification. And you want to identify with Jesus in his death, in his burial, and in his resurrection.
Yeah, Lord.
That's what the Bible called the full gospel. Heaven said the full gospel. Jesus did more than die for your sin.